avoiding a catastrophic default. In that meeting, I made clear that I'm going to support the legislation that is on the floor today, and that I support it without hesitation, reservation, or trepidation. Not because it's perfect, but in divided government, we of course cannot allow the perfect to be the enemy of the good. And President Biden did an incredibly good job under difficult circumstances in protecting some key priorities and values for the well-being of the American people. This process has been one where the extreme MAGA Republicans were determined to take the country down one of either two directions. Door number one, they wanted dramatic, draconian, devastating cuts that would have adversely impacted the health, the safety, or the economic well-being of the American people. And they were going to use a hostage-taking situation to force those extreme right-wing cuts down the throats of the American people. Door number two, if they are unable to get the draconian, dramatic, devastating cuts consistent with what was in their extreme Default on America Act that they passed on the House floor, with the deciding vote being the serial fraudster George Santos on April 26th, if they were unable to get the Default on America Act, they were willing to walk America through door number two. And door number two was a devastating, dangerous default. Crash the economy. Trigger a job-killing recession. Because as many of them indicated, including the chair of the Republican National Committee, that they believed that a default and a crashing of the economy would benefit them politically in 2024. Those are the options that they presented to the American people. So I'm thankful for the leadership of President Joe Biden, who found a third path. And it's a third path that does three important things. One, it avoids a devastating default, avoids crashing the economy, avoids triggering a job-killing recession here in America and throughout the world, and avoids hurting millions of everyday Americans. The second thing that President Biden and his team were able to do successfully in partnership with House Democrats and Senate Democrats every step of the way was to make sure that America would not be forced in another hostage-taking situation for the balance of this Congress. And it was incredibly important to make sure that the debt ceiling was suspended through the early part of 2025, so that the American people don't have to be subjected to this type of turmoil for the balance of this year and all throughout next year. And it gives us the space to work through how we can prevent this type of hostage-taking situation legislatively, legally, or administratively ever again. And then the third important thing that the Biden administration was able to accomplish is that they protected some things that were incredibly important to the American people, all of which were on the chopping block because of the extreme MAGA Republicans and their ransom demands from the very beginning of this year. But because President Biden held the line, some very important things were protected in this resolution. President Biden protected Social Security. President Biden protected Medicare. President Biden protected Medicaid. President Biden protected veterans. President Biden protected the Inflation Reduction Act. President Biden protected the clean energy tax credits that will be transformational. President Biden protected billions of dollars in funding to combat environmental injustice. And President Biden protected the American people from the types of devastating cuts proposed by right-wing extremists that would have hurt millions of everyday Americans. That was all accomplished as a result of this resolution. And I'm thankful for the leadership of President Biden, House Democrats who stood strongly behind him and his administration, Leader Schumer, and Senate Democrats as well. It's now my honor to yield to the distinguished whip of the House Democratic Caucus, who has held this caucus together in such an extraordinary way. From the first week of the 118th Congress through the Default on America Act, where every single House Democrat opposed the extreme MAGA Republican legislation, giving the administration tremendous strength in the negotiating room, all the way through making sure that every single Democrat, New Dems, Blue Dogs, progressives, all points in between, signed the discharge petition to strengthen the leverage that the Biden administration needed to bring about an outcome that protected the well-being of the American people. Thank you, Catherine Clark.
Thank you, Mr. Leader. We are inspired by your leadership, and it continues to be demonstrated, and we are still to this day so proud to have cast 3,179 votes for Hakeem Jeffries for Speaker. But today, let me start off with what we know. It's been nearly 3 months since President Biden released his budget, his vision on how we can invest in the American people and at the same time reduce our deficit. And every day since, it has been Democrats and the president who've been fighting on the side of the American people. It is Democrats who've been the adults in the room. It is Democrats who've prioritized Americans over political gamesmanship. It's Democrats who've opposed this MAGA hostage situation. It's Democrats who have always been clear, we will not allow this country to suffer a devastating default. The question is whether Republicans today will decide to join us and do the right thing. This is a deal that Speaker McCarthy negotiated. When his predecessor negotiated an agreement on the debt ceiling, she guaranteed the votes from the vast majority of her caucus. Now, nobody is mistaking Speaker McCarthy for Speaker Pelosi, but he should be able to do what he said he was going to do and produce 150 votes from this majority. That should be on the table. And the fact that it is still an open question, the fact that we still don't know if the votes are there, that he is depending on Democrats to avert disaster, that is a reflection of the extremism, of the brinksmanship, and the ideological rot that has taken hold of the Republican Party. Like all of you, I am eager to see the Republicans' final tally. But this caucus will remain unified with the president and, most importantly, with the American people in this fight. And I am very proud to yield to our chairman, who has been helping us at every step of the way keep our caucus informed and together, and that's Chairman Pete Aguilar.
Thank you, Whip Clark. Thanks to Whip Clark and Leader Jeffries for their leadership. For their comments to the House Democrats this morning, for the unity of purpose that they exude every day. This week we'll bring an end to the Republican-led and Republican-manufactured crisis. House Democrats look forward to continuing to tout the achievements of the Biden-Harris administration, 12.7 new jobs created. But when we reflect on this week, it's important to know this wasn't about deficits. This was never about deficits to Republicans. They turned down every reasonable opportunity to close loopholes that would affect our deficits. They want to stand behind their billionaire friends so they can pay less than teachers on their tax rate than teachers in San Bernardino. That's what this is about. And they're going to show us throughout the summer. Our prediction is that they're going to mark up a tax bill that would blow another hole over $3 trillion in the deficit. This is not about fiscal sanity. This is about them each and every step of the way protecting their billionaire friends. But House Democrats stand poised to help, stand poised to be the adults in the room, and we will ensure that we put this crisis behind us. We've had a number of briefings with the administration officials. I am appreciative of them. I continue to appreciate the president standing up for Medicare and Social Security and Medicaid. Without that leadership and support, those programs would not have been protected in this deal and in this year. We've had a number of administration briefings, six briefings. The administration just spent 2 hours briefing House Democrats, and we appreciate their willingness to do that. And a partner in that process who was, all of the members of the leadership team were on these Zooms and on these calls and there today. But a partner in this has been Vice Chair Ted Lieu.
Thank you, Chairman Aguilar. And let me first start off by commending Hakeem Jeffries, Catherine Clark, and Pete Aguilar for their strong leadership and for putting the American people first. And what all of you have seen since day one of the 118th Congress is that President Biden and House Democrats have remained calm, cool, and collected in the face of repeated Republican chaos. This is a GOP manufactured crisis. This is a routine vote. It was so routine that three times it happened under the former president with no fanfare. But Republicans chose, because of how extreme they've gotten, to take us to the brink of a disaster, and Democrats are not going to let that happen. And what we've seen in particular from President Biden is that he gets stuff done. President Biden and Democrats negotiated a bipartisan infrastructure law to rebuild your roads and bridges and highways. President Biden and Democrats negotiated a bipartisan CHIPS and Science Act to bring back high-tech manufacturing to America. President Biden and Democrats negotiated the PACT Act to protect our veterans. This bipartisan agreement today protects all of those historic laws. And in particular, as a veteran myself, I'm very pleased that this agreement fully funds veterans' health care at the insistence of Democrats. It was not that long ago that Republicans passed the Default on America Act that cut veterans' funding by 22%. And because of the leadership of Democrats and President Biden, we were able to restore that funding and fully fund veterans' health care, as well as the Toxic Exposure Fund in the PACT Act. And because of that, I will be supporting the bill today. And now I yield back to Leader Jeffries.
Thank you, Ted. Thank you, Pete. Thank you, Catherine. Questions?
Leader Jeffries, you say that Speaker McCarthy negotiated this bill. The White House was also negotiating this bill as well. So what is your message to progressive members in your caucus who say that those work requirements should have never been on the table?
Same message that I just delivered from this podium is the exact message that I delivered in my conversations to all House Democrats throughout the last several days as we've been working through receiving information from the administration and in the context of the discussion earlier today. Now, Speaker McCarthy and the House Republicans had the negotiating oar in terms of both the House and the Senate in this context. And so as Catherine Clark indicated, it's our expectation that at minimum, House Republicans will produce two-thirds of their conference to support a resolution that they negotiated after driving the country into a hostage-taking situation on the brink of default. 150 votes is what the House Republicans need to produce, consistent with what they've agreed to do in terms of getting this bill over the finish line. House Democrats are going to make sure that the country does not default, period, full stop. We will continue to be responsible stewards of our economy, and we will not let middle-class Americans, working families, those who aspire to be part of the middle class, seniors, veterans, the poor, the sick, and the afflicted, be hurt by a dangerous GOP manufactured default. We will not let that happen. But at the same time, it is important for House Republicans to do their part in supporting a resolution that they themselves negotiated.
You're saying that Democrats are unified behind this deal, behind this.
I didn't say that. I said that we are unified in avoiding a default. We are unified as it relates to why the country is in this situation. And we're unified behind the leadership that President Biden has provided.
But in order to avoid a default, you would have to pass this bill tonight. You're already starting to see some Democrats say no, like Chairwoman Pramila Jayapal has come out and said no. Is this fracturing the conference, and how do you mend those relationships? Have you reached out to her?
Conference is not fractured at all. I had a very good conversation with Pramila Jayapal earlier today. Unity is different from unanimity. The great Jim Clyburn has always reminded us. We will continue to be unified. We are going to make sure that we avoid a default, and then we'll be unified as we move forward in building an economy that works for everyday Americans from the middle out and from the ground up. And we look forward to taking on some additional fights for the American people, including stopping the extreme MAGA Republicans from trying to jam another tax giveaway for the wealthy, the well-off, and the well-connected down the throats of the American people. We will continue to be unified in all of those efforts.
Mr. Leader.
Third row.
This 1% cut to the budget, if all 12 appropriations bills aren't passed, what does that say for the appropriations process later this year? How is that going to affect how things are going to go, and does it raise the chance of an omnibus bill? How is this going to work?
We all have full confidence in the House Democratic leader on the Appropriations Committee, Rosa DeLauro, the once and future chairwoman of the Appropriations Committee, to defend Democratic priorities, to fight for the middle class, for working families, for young people, for older Americans, for those who aspire to be part of the middle class, for vulnerable Americans. And as we resolve this default crisis and then hand over the reins to the Appropriations Committee, I believe that we couldn't be better served than from the leadership of Rosa DeLauro.
Speaker,
what's the latest update you received from Speaker McCarthy about how many votes Democrats will need to deliver on both the bill itself but also the rule?
Let me defer to Catherine Clark on the rule. On the bill itself, we haven't gotten a precise number from the other side of the aisle yet, but we continue to maintain that House Republicans need to keep their commitment to produce 150 votes for the resolution that they themselves negotiated. And when that happens, Democrats are going to make sure that there is no default.
In regards to the rule, it's very simple. The majority is responsible for passing the rule.
If he doesn't have them?
I think, as Catherine indicated, the majority is responsible for ensuring the passage of the rule. But we will not allow a default to happen.
Mr. Leader, you used the phrase hostage-taking. At the end of the day, Everybody negotiated over the debt ceiling. What does this mean whenever the next time comes around?
Well, I think President Biden and Democrats in the House and the Senate were very clear that we were going to proceed on parallel tracks from the very beginning. And parallel tracks meant for us that we would avoid a default and that whatever resolution occurred relative to the spending side of the equation related to the appropriations process had to match in duration suspending the debt ceiling. It wasn't the original plan from the extreme MAGA Republicans. Their original plan, as you know, 10 years of draconian spending caps in exchange for an 11 or 12 month suspension of the debt ceiling. Are you kidding me? Give us a break. That was their position. And that's not the resolution.
Did you have to forecast or pledge a certain number of Democrats to get through this?
Thank you, Mr. Leader. Thank you. Sure. Yesterday, Congressman Jayapal also said that she felt the deal that is on the table today would have been better had House Democrats had more voice, and she said she felt that would have been the case if you had a more consistent presence at the negotiating table. Do you agree with that?
Well, I'm thankful for her comments, but I've got full faith, and as I believe all of us do, certainly in President Biden and in the team of designees that were in the negotiating room. Every single member of the House Democratic Caucus has great confidence in Director Shalonda Young in particular. In fact, before she said a word today, she received a standing ovation from every single person because we have great confidence in her ability. It was an enlightened decision when President Biden put her into that negotiating room, and we knew that she would defend our values, and she did.
There's been some talk of Democrats holding their votes tonight to show that Republicans couldn't pass it alone and then provide the votes later on to prove a point. Do you think that this is something that's been discussed, and do you think this is an appropriate course of action?
And there was no discussion of that either in the meeting that we had earlier today with all of the top Democrats on the standing committees or in a 2-hour and 15-minute meeting that we had in the caucus.
But you did say that the Republicans have to keep their commitment to 150 votes. And I think you actually said, and then the Democrats will. So what happens if they do not provide 150? What if they're sitting up there at 130?
Well, to be clear, it's our expectation that House Republicans will keep their commitment to provide 150 or so votes as a floor for an agreement that they themselves negotiate. This is not an agreement that Mitch McConnell negotiated that came over from the Senate, that Leader Schumer negotiated. They were the ones who were in the room. And so I think it's reasonable for the American people to conclude that this is going to be a bipartisan resolution to a manufactured default crisis that they created. In terms of functionality, you know, and what happens during the 15-minute vote series or things of that nature, none of us have gotten into any of those mechanics because we've been very clear. We will not allow the country to default. America must always pay our bills. We will not let extreme MAGA Republicans in the Congress crash our economy and hurt everyday Americans. Period. Full stop. Mechanically, what that looks like on the House floor remains to be seen.
Thank you, Leader Jeffries. Do you think the White House gave up too much or relented in that they had said that work requirements was a red line? They gave in to improved work requirements. And second, what's your reaction to summon the Freedom Caucus threatening to file a motion to vacate the chair. If that were to happen, would Democrats stand behind Speaker McCarthy, given that reportedly that Dems feel that, you know, there could always be a worse option?
Well, we'll cross that bridge when we get to it, and there's been no discussion over the last several days in any of the meetings that we've had as it relates to any hypothetical motion to vacate the chair. Our mission is clear. Make sure that we prevent a catastrophic default from being visited upon the American people, period, full stop. That's our mission. In terms of the so-called work requirements, which, by the way, have been in law since 1996, this was a phony, fake talking point injected unnecessarily into this discussion. Let's be clear about that, okay? The overwhelming majority of people who receive SNAP or TANF are already subject to work requirements because of the 1996 law. Now, in this situation, I think President Biden and his team did the best that they could, and in fact, expanded eligibility for veterans, expanded eligibility in terms of SNAP for homeless and the unhoused, and expanded eligibility for young people who have aged out of foster care. That's an extraordinary accomplishment. And what the Congressional Budget Office has had to say about this development speaks for itself.
Last question.
I was wondering how you feel about the 72-hour rule, if that should remain in place going forward, if that's something you would strike down if you were to take back Congress.
Yeah, I'll respond to that, but I want to give everyone an opportunity just to offer some closing thoughts. Catherine, Pete, and Ted.
I would just echo what the leader said. I mean, House Democrats stand poised to avert this crisis. Personally, from the vice chair and I, we appreciate the administration coming up here, continuing briefings, the documentation that they have sent over to help members arrive at a decision that is best for their districts has been helpful. Over the last 48 hours at the leader's request, we have had six deep dive briefings, plus the caucus session this morning. That's 9 hours. Over the last 48 hours, House Democrats have been digesting information to make the best decision we can to avert this Republican-led crisis. That's where we're at. And we appreciate all of the information that we have taken in, and members will make the decision that is best for them.
House Democrats are very clear. There is no perfect negotiation when you are the victims of extortion. Nobody likes to pay a ransom note, and that's exactly what tonight's vote is, our payment on the ransom of the American people. The MAGA Republicans, the extremists have taken them hostage, offered, as the leader set forth, a lose-lose proposition. We either have devastating cuts or we lose 8 million jobs overnight, spike the cost of home ownership, of car loans. Last time we even got close to default, Americans on the verge of retirement lost on average $20,000 of their life savings. This is how the MAGA extremists view the American people. It doesn't matter what will happen to them as long as they are winning their political game. And who's at the center? It's families at home. It's workers. It's small businesses. It is the full faith and credit of the United States. And not only the recession and economic catastrophe, it could start here, but trigger globally. So at a time where our president is asserting the strength of our country, here and abroad, bringing manufacturing back, investing in infrastructure and climate resiliency, strengthening NATO, siding with Ukraine and standing for democracies around the world. This is the vision of the Republican Conference? That you put all that at stake For what? For what? To make that winner circle so small that only the very rich and already well-connected continue to prosper, and you're willing to cut off opportunity for American families who are trying to get by, recover from the pandemic, get back on their feet? It's hard to take in because it is so cartoon villain-like. But unlike a cartoon, the American people won't snap back up when you drop that economic anvil on their head. This is where we are, and we are grateful to the leadership from this White House, to the leadership from the Democratic caucus, and what we anticipate we are going to see from our Democratic colleagues in the Senate, for putting the American people first in steering the way for this country back to sanity and rejecting extremism.
I just want to remind people again why we're here today. It's because under the former administration, Republicans passed a massive tax cut that benefited the top 1%, and they don't want to pay for that. Another reason we're here today is because Republicans took a routine vote and jacked it up and put us on the brink of disaster. MAGA Republicans will fail in their attempt to crash the U.S. economy, and that's because President Biden and Democrats are standing strong. We're going to make sure our country does not default and that we in America remain the leader of the free world.
Thank you again to Whip Clark and Chairman Aguilar and Vice Chair Liu. Over the last 72 hours, the communication between the White House, the Biden administration, and House Democrats has been clear, consistent, and comprehensive. And I thank the White House for making everyone available at the highest level under the leadership on our side of Chairman Aguilar and Vice Chair Liu to make sure that there was a robust, active, authentic discussion so that every member can make an informed decision later on this afternoon and this evening as it relates to the legislation that will be in front of us and in front of the American people. What is clear is that President Biden has succeeded in protecting the American people from some of the most harmful and aggressive things that the Republicans were trying to jam down our throats. Protected Social Security, protected Medicare, protected Medicaid, protected veterans, protected the middle class, all those who aspire to be part of it, working families, the poor, the sick, and the afflicted, from the types of devastating cuts that extreme MAGA Republicans were determined to enact. And as a result of the efforts of the Biden administration, we're going to be able to make sure here in the House and in the Senate that America does not default and that our economy does not crash. And we will all live to fight another day in fighting for the people.
72-hour rule. Friends. Yeah. Melina's off this week. This is the perfect week.